Hello everybody, Mugsy here, super excited to share with you some really interesting information about one of our plant ancestors. I was getting ready for the growing season by starting some of my favorite vegetables inside, and as I was planting all these seeds, I started thinking about the really interesting story of Brassica oleracea. If you went into any modern supermarket today and asked for Brassica oleracea, you would get a raised eyebrow at the least. And that's not just because we don't commonly ask for plants by their scientific name at the grocery store, but also because Brassica oleracea is actually many different vegetables. It's kale, it's broccoli, it's Brussels sprouts, it's kohlrabi, it's mustard greens, it's collard greens. It is so many things, and it is all Brassica oleracea. So today I'm going to share with you the story about how one plant became several and how this influenced our human evolution. And towards the end of the video, I'm going to give you a little bit of information on growing them, because these are great varieties of plants to have in your garden. So the story starts about 2000 BCE on the cliffsides and mountains of coastal Western and Southern Europe with wild cabbage, also called wild mustard. Brassica oleracea by any other name. And this wild plant was perceived by our human ancestors. They tasted it, they saw that it was edible, and eventually began to cultivate and domesticate it. Humans love to work with nature and cultivate the aspects that we find useful. Take, for example, of course, our household friends, the dogs. You have a huge variety of sizes and temperaments for dogs, but they're all canine domesticus, and they all come from the gray wolf. And it's basically the same premise. Human beings go out into the wild and we find species that are useful to us, and then we put energy into cultivating certain aspects of them. So for dogs, we supported the most social of the wolves until they became our companions, and then from there we got a variety of breeds specific to different purposes such as protection, hunting, foraging, and hanging out, shepherding. Now the historical record is a little bit fuzzy. We don't know the whole story, but we know certain facts, and we also have looked to the genomes that have been studied by plant scientists. So our earliest records of Brassica oleracea come to us from ancient Greece, where this plant was specifically cultivated for its leaves, giving us kale, collard greens, mustard greens. While we have historical record of ancient Greece, we know that it was also domesticated in a wide variety of civilizations around the world, and those domesticated varieties often spread beyond their gardens back into the wild and then were re-domesticated. This is a plant with a great amount of natural genetic variation that was only compounded by human interference. We see historically, cabbage comes up around the 10th century. And the part of the plant that cabbage is focused on is what's called the terminal leaf bud. So if we look at the way that plants are grown, the terminal leaf bud is basically the bundle of leaves before it opens up at the top. So you have shoots of leaves at the side, but you also have the terminal leaf bud. That's why when you look at a cabbage, from one seed you get one cabbage. But Brussels sprouts were cultivated for the lateral leaf bud. Those are the ones that are growing along the stem. So when you look at the growing habit of a Brussels sprout, you begin to see what happens when people put so much energy into emphasizing one particular part of a plant. And Brussels sprouts pops up around 18th century in Belgium. We see kohlrabi start popping up around the 1500s. And interestingly, the name kohlrabi is actually German, meaning cabbage turnip, a nod to the fact that it is in fact very closely, directly related to the cabbage, but the part of the plant that we eat is this bulbous stem, similar to the turnip. And then, of course, we have my favorite brassica, which is broccoli. Now, the part of the broccoli that we typically eat, this tasty stuff on the top here is called the floret. Same with cauliflower. And these are actually flower buds. If you leave broccoli and you don't harvest it in time, all these compact flower buds will bloom into an ocean of little yellow flowers. Interestingly, I've seen that with broccoli, but I've also seen that with kale. Only because kale is more emphasized on the leaves, you get a lot less yellow flowers. But those yellow flowers looked exactly the same. Another brassica that is emphasizing the flower buds is the cauliflower. However, those have been cultivated in such a way that you're not really going to see those bloom anymore. And the reason I'm just so knee-deep in brassicas is because their growing habits are pretty much the same across the board. So these are plants that like cool weather, so that's why I'm getting them started now. I'm starting my seeds indoors in early March, but come mid to late April, I'm gonna transplant these outside, and they're not gonna mind a little bit of cold weather. This is why a lot of cool weather crops also don't mind growing in the fall, so it's very likely that I'll be starting these in the late summer for another bumper crop in the fall. These seeds all look the same. They're all planted at a quarter inch depth, and they're all gonna take about 7 to 10 days to germinate. It's really important then that you make sure you have a plant label, because I'm telling you, these sprouts are gonna look the same, so you're gonna wanna know what you're growing. I think it's worth mentioning, since we've talked about the story of how wild cabbage was domesticated by humans, to also touch on the fact that I think that these wild plants also sort of domesticated us. We know that our wild ancestors were hunters and gatherers, and they had a very different lifestyle than the one that we know today. But after generations of observing plants and working with them, humans decided that we would actually cultivate them in one spot. In the transition period between hunting and gathering and civilization, people would plant stands of vegetables and fruits and travel place to place. But eventually we decided we were going to settle on one spot and focus on our crops. We are working hard for our plants. We are making sure that the land is cleared. We are bringing water to them. We are, in a sense, domesticated by our relationship with plants too. Because if it wasn't for this transition from gathering to farming, would we be living in these boxes and these bricks, right? So I think that while we can look at the diversity of forms of Brassica oleracea as a nod to human ingenuity, we should also pay some respect for the fact that these plants kind of domesticated us too. So that's Mugsy's thoughts on brassicas. I hope you're excited to get your plants started for this growing season coming up. I know I am. And stick around for more exciting gardening facts. You're going to get to watch our garden grow and learn about the evolution and history of some of our most interesting plants and vegetables. So stick around, and I'll talk to you soon.